Okay, so who has heard of Phidgets? Just, okay. Who has heard of Arduino? And who has heard of Raspberry Pi? Seems to be the same people every time. And lastly, who remembers me from my time at the university? Okay, I don't feel so bad because I don't really remember very many of you either. Okay, so the easiest to understand is Raspberry Pi. It's a very cheap, small computer running Linux. Arduino is even simpler. It's a little CPU microcontroller on a circuit board where your code runs right on the hardware, no operating system in the way. Fidgets are quite a bit different from these two, although there's a lot of comparison between them and competition between them. Fidgets are basically USB peripherals. If you want to measure the temperature of an open flame from an iPhone app you're writing, we'll ship you the hardware today, you'll have it tomorrow, and you'll have it going the same day. We make several dozen different devices, each focused on a specific function. Your code runs right on your computer, you work in your familiar development environment. Communication with the fidgets is handled by objects or APIs. Fidgets are basically black box. Measuring temperature is our problem, not yours. If you want to measure temperature or control a motor with a Raspberry Pi or an Arduino, you get into circuit design. And if that's what you want to do, then it's a superior solution for sure. You can learn a lot designing your own circuits. If you just want to measure temperature tomorrow, then fidgets are a good solution. So who has started a business? Who wants to start a business? My advice for you? Don't. You're probably not going to hear that a lot at the talk here, at a lot of these talks. But you know, most of us can get an education, we can find a job, we can stay employed most of the time, we can find a partner and start a family if we choose. You know, the odds favor success. Whereas for businesses, the vast majority of businesses fail, or they limp along and do so badly that they should be put down. You know, society needs people to start businesses. But the average person who feels this entrepreneurial pull to start a business, they end up being poorer for it. But what I find with the people who choose to start businesses is they don't care. They're going to do it anyway. So for people who decide they're going to start a business, I hope this talk can be of some benefit to you. Because you may as well, if you're going to do it anyway, you may as well bring the odds in your favor as much as you can. So I got involved with building devices called fidgets in the second year of my computer science degree. This professor at HCI in computer science, Saul Greenberg, he had this idea of making controllers and sensors that you could plug into the computer and they would have programming APIs. The basic problem was is that they wanted to control little motors and measure sensors from the computer. This is back in the 90s when there was much less options available for this. And so they would involve electrical engineers in their projects. The electrical engineers would build a system for the computer programmers in HCI. And after the research project was over, they'd write a paper, but the system ended up being completely unmaintainable. So Saul Greenberg had the idea that if he got the engineers to build him, say, 10 boards that had a programming API and they could just plug them into the computer, then it wouldn't matter that it was unmaintainable because they'd have 10. And they could send it to their friends around the country if somebody else wanted to use this sensor. And it was a sort of academic approach to solving this hardware design problem. So my training amounted to paying attention in Chris Walpole's classes. Everybody remembers Chris Walpole, I'm sure. He's retired now. I'm from computer science. I didn't have any training in electrical engineering. But I promised the world, and I managed to cobble a few devices together. Actually, in the first few early months, I quit my job driving truck on the weekends, and I was unable to get anything working for the first few months because they had a serial cable. Saul had a serial cable with a broken wire in it. That sometimes it would work. Like I'd take it downstairs to the main lab on the first floor, and it would work there, and then I'd take it back upstairs, and it wouldn't work anymore. So I bought myself a $1,500 oscilloscope with my own money, because I hadn't delivered any results and I felt so bad. And slowly I managed to figure it out. So I finished my bachelor's and I graduated right as the dot-com bubble collapsed. The Fidgets project was far enough along that I could write a thesis and get a master's degree. We'd already published some papers. So I entered the master's program because there really wasn't any work out there. And even though I was really kind of done with school, and it turned out that I was done with school, after about 4 months in the master's program, I moved to a friend's basement in Cochrane and I started Phidgets as a business. So that was early 2002. The first 2 years of Phidgets were really, really hard. Some of the skills required brings back pain to see the list. Hardware designer, firmware coder, systems architect, tech support, sales desk, systems administrator, website designer and coder, bookkeeper, technical writer, manufacturing planner, solder flunky. The hard fact is that one person can't be all these things. You get to be bad at everything. Some of the repetitive mistakes I made. I didn't take weekends off. I was burned out most of the time. Investing time and money in better tools seemed like a waste of time. I could have saved many months of development effort if I would have just spent a few days being more organized. And another mistake was listening to customers, which, again, sounds funny. But if you're running a service company, you need customers that pay your contract rate and you do their work, basically. In contrast, in a product company, you need to have a clear vision of what your product is, and you can't allow an individual customer to drag your idea of a product back and forth. Otherwise, you just end up being a service company that's selling a very cheap product to one customer. But when you're slowly sinking, the company's going broke, any opportunity looks good, and it can be a deadly distraction. But one thing I did right was I lived really, really cheap. I shared a duplex with two roommates, had the company in the house, drove the cheapest possible cars, I don't know how I survived them, and I bought the cheapest possible equipment for the company. I mean, it seems obvious, but actually it's hard to do. There's a peculiar psychology when you're losing money. When you're making money, you live within the cash flow. Like if you have $100,000 coming in every month, you don't spend more than $100,000 every month on average. But when you're losing money, you don't think about the cash flow because usually there is none. So instead you think, I have $67,000 of cash or credit available, just to pick a number. And it feels like a lot of money. So you tell yourself crazy things like, I'm going to be in production in 6 months, so I'm going to need this machine, so I may as well buy it now. Or I'll have this new motor controller out in 2 months, so I may as well buy the motors that go with it now. If this seems kind of specific, that's because I did that. I thought the motor controller would be out in 2 months, so I bought the motors, and it actually wasn't out for 6 years. So 2 years later, 2 years in, the company was still losing money. Cash was long gone, and I was $130,000 in debt. I started the company without investors, but a lot of that debt was co-signed by my father. Two key decisions turned the tide. I met my wife, and she was, and still is, a stabilizing influence on me. I started taking weekends off, and my work week became much more productive. Also, I hired someone full-time. Officially, his title was business manager. You know, in reality, if you're a company of two people and you have a business manager, that's a really, really bad sign. But so he wasn't really a business manager. But between the two of us, we could specialize a little bit. He worried about making the website look better and replacing all the photos I had taken of products, which looked absolutely terrible. I could worry more about actually getting products finished and making the libraries better. So things got better, except we were still losing money. The sales hadn't caught up at all. So by the end of June, this would have been June 2004, I was thinking about shutting the company down in 2 weeks. And you know, people who start businesses, they tend to be irrepressible optimists. You know, they just don't understand failure. So the fact that I was even thinking about shutting down means that it was really, really bad. And within those 2 weeks, two companies approached us about distributing our products. And just all of a sudden, it passed this inflection point where the website looked better and we had distributors. So the distributors were buying and all of a sudden people were buying through the website. And it was just amazing how it turned around. So my wife still clearly remembers the fax orders coming in from Japan at 2 a.m. because the fax machine was in the other room. So when it rang at 2 o'clock in the morning, it would wake me up and I would go check out the order, and it was great. Manufacturing became the bottleneck. I'd been assembling the boards by hand. So all the little surface mount components, I put them down with tweezers. I built the first 7,000 boards by hand, and some helpers built the next 6,000 boards by hand. We continued hand-assembling circuit boards for another year, mostly because I didn't know anybody who had ever contracted out circuit board assembly. But eventually, this hand assembly just became totally unbearable. So we bit the bullet and did a big production run. I mean, it felt big at the time. It was about 4,000 boards at a Canadian contract manufacturer. And it was a disaster. The quality was terrible. I had to buy professional repair tools, and I sat down at night and I fixed them all myself by hand. That was painful. There was a lesson about that. When you visit a factory, you focus on what they actually do for work. You don't look at the machine in the corner that's lonely and isn't getting used. When you're doing business with a factory, no matter what they tell you, you have to do business with what they're good at, not all the other stuff they're promising. But we carried on and we made money. It was nice not to be completely stressed about money all the time. Nice to be able to pay the other guy. So in 2006, I bought a plane ticket to China. Two reasons. The experience with local manufacturing hadn't been great. And the real push was that the European community was outlawing the use of lead in the solder used to assemble the circuit boards. And any Calgary manufacturer that we could afford was not interested in spending a bunch of money and buying new equipment to comply with European law. There was a lot of resistance from local manufacturers for that, because most local Calgary manufacturers, they manufacture for the Canadian market, whereas the Chinese, they manufacture for the world, so they had been pushed on this for years ahead of time. After, yep. Yep. Although actually, as an experiment on the talk, the first half of my talk is scripted like this, and the second half, we have a set of 12 questions, 12 really common questions that I'll crush, and then we'll just open up the floor. So the trip was totally unplanned. Marta's boss, he sort of joked about this, you're just going to fly to China and figure out manufacturing in China, but this is the kind of thing you can do when you're young. You just don't understand failure. And you know, I had no idea what I was doing, so there's not really much point in putting together a plan. But I'll deviate from the script a little bit. It was pretty funny. I had one factory that I was going to start with first. There was no reason to visit the factory, and actually it was kind of awkward on the visit because I had no business reason for being there. So finally they asked, what are you doing here? But, you know, I landed in Shanghai and managed to get a train to Ningbo, which is in this really industrial area south of there. And by the time I get to Ningbo, like you're one train ride into China, and there's no English anymore. You know, there's 1 out of 100 people speaking English. And I managed to get on a bus to the city of Xixi. The pronunciation's probably wrong. And I'm on the bus thinking, you know, there's less and less, like there's already no English. And things are looking more and more industrial and rural all the time. Fortunately, there was a German guy on the bus, so I got to talking to him. And he had just quit his job because his coworker thought they should start a business together. So he had went to the city of Ningbo, and then his coworker stopped answering his phone. So I hired him as an interpreter. He had an MBA. He went to China, got an MBA in China. And it was great fun. I went to China assuming that I wouldn't be able to, that I would be able to just bulldoze my way around without having an interpreter. So, you know, running as a tourist in China without an interpreter, that's a lot of fun. But for business, don't waste your time. Get the interpreter, it's worth the $60 a day. So manufacturing in China has had its challenges, but it was absolutely worth it. Unfortunately, there was a lot we didn't know, and the factories in general, don't like to tell the guy with the money what he's doing wrong. They'll just work around you somehow. Our inexperience created long delays, and all the material, the components, accumulated at the factory. These components, and the incredibly bad way we modeled it in our accounting system, conspired to create the next disaster. So I'm not good at bookkeeping. It's a pretty boring thing to do. In the early years, I fooled myself that I would get the books fixed. As for the first 2 years, I wasn't filing anything with the government, and it was just impossible, looking back on it, to get the accounting system put together with what I knew about accounting and my natural inclinations to not doing books. So finally, a coworker grabbed the accounting system from me, and he was a way better bookkeeper than I'll ever be, but a very bad decision was made. When a business buys inventory, you're trading an asset, cash, for another asset, inventory. Even though you have less money, there's no effect on your taxes until you sell the inventory or you pour gas on it and light it on fire. It has to be gone in order for it to decrease your taxes. In our accounting system, when we bought components, we treated them as being immediately sold. So this is a good shortcut. It's a good system if you're an electrician and you've got a few spools of wire in the back of your truck. There's no point in inventorying a little bit of copper wire. But for a manufacturer who's accumulating hundreds of thousands of dollars in components at a factory, it is a disaster. And so at the end of the year, all the components that remain are unreported income. And this got worse from year to year, because we were always pushing ahead of the manufacturing. So by the time the bookkeeper quit, the problem was larger than the value of the company. I got a crash course in accounting, because all of a sudden there wasn't anybody doing bookkeeping anymore. And I've never looked back. If you like programming and algorithms, you'll like accounting. If you think you don't like accounting, you can come over to my house with a case of beer, and by the end of the evening, I'll have infected you with my passion for accounting. It's actually pretty cool. Bookkeeping is boring. You know, you need somebody else to do the books for sure. But accounting is a pretty neat system. So we plowed forward and fixed the problem. It took a lot of money to make Revenue Canada happy with all this unreported income. But actually, they were really professional and straightforward to deal with. As long as they get their money, they're happy. If you're ever in a similar situation, there's a government program called Voluntary Disclosure, where if you tell them about the problem before they find the problem, they won't charge you any penalties. You still pay the interest. So while we're on the topic of taxes, a lot of thought goes into reducing taxes and avoiding taxes. There's a lot of lawyers, accountants, consultants who will spend a lot of your money telling you about how to reduce your taxes. And giving all your money to a consultant is an effective way of reducing your taxes, but it's quite a bit cheaper to just pay the government. So my advice is pay your taxes and focus on increasing your profit. And if you leave the profit in the company, the tax rate in Alberta is really, really low. It's really nothing to complain about. So after you've had a serious accounting disaster, you'll never want to have another one. So this was my priority for 2009, was to never have to face a nightmare like this again when I drive into work. Ideally, the accounting system should reflect exactly the state of the company, moment by moment, as it operates. This is easy for a coffee shop, but it's really difficult for a company doing manufacturing. Your accounting system needs to know, I better just read this, needs to know the cost and quantity of every component and product the company owns. System needs to know how components are turned into finished product, when products and components currently on order will arrive at locations around the world, when manufacturing is scheduled, and the rate products are being sold at. In effect, for the computer science brain, the accounting system needs to know the current state of the company and needs to have enough information to run a simulation forward in time. That's how I think about it. People who work with these systems don't think about it that way, but that's basically what it is. So if you don't have all of this, planning, purchasing, and manufacturing is a Herculean effort, and the accountant cannot hope for it. It doesn't have a chance of being right. So our $200 copy of QuickBooks didn't have any of this. I went shopping for heavy-duty accounting software. It's called ERP, Enterprise Resource Planning. This is a known problem. There's lots of software that will do this. The base software of an ERP system is utterly unusable. This is just speaking from my own experience of looking at these systems. You plan on paying a consultant, or many consultants, $1,500 a day to create new forms for the software. And the industry standard is that for every dollar you pay for the software, you pay $2 for the consultants to make it usable. So the minimum system we were looking at was not really that good. It wasn't certainly would have been really painful for us to work with. And the average installed cost of this software was $1 million. So it wasn't a good feeling. You know, we'd solved our accounting problem and the government was happy, but we had no way of preventing it from coming back again. But it turns out this is the advantage of being a small company. The real problem is not that complicated. So I went and brainstormed with my strongest developer for 8 hours. And in 3 weeks, he built an application that sits on top of our $200 copy of QuickBooks. And it did everything that the accounting system didn't understand. The accounting system understands today. It understands what you own today, but it doesn't understand what's going to happen in the future. It doesn't understand how all these products get welded together, what the manufacturing plan is going to look like, how shipping around the world looks like. So we just built a database and an application that sat on top of the accounting system and did all the stuff that the accounting system didn't understand. And it took him 3 weeks. And in technical terms, we built our own MRP system. MRP is basically a subset of ERP. ERP grew out of MRP as the whole thing gets bigger and bigger over the years. And basically it's focused on manufacturing. So making your own MRP system, everyone will tell you this is a really, really bad idea. And that's kind of the business rule, is bad idea. What most people don't realize is that this wisdom applies to big companies. For a big company to roll its own MRP system would be a bad idea. But if you're small and you're smart and you're building only what you need and nothing more, then a lot of the rules of business don't apply to you. So we built our own MRP system, and that felt great. So we finished the year of the accounting disaster with a knock at the door. The bylaw officer wanted to see our business license. And of course, we didn't have one. Since 2003, we'd been in a little duplex just east of the university in Capitol Hill. And you know, even if we had asked for a business license, they wouldn't have given us a business license to have 11 people working in a duplex in the middle of a residential area. Maybe with some soldering irons in there too. But you know, the city of Calgary was great. The guy said, "We know what happened here. You know, you had a little business. It grew up. It got bigger and bigger. Now you need a business license." And effectively, what that was saying is, now you need to move out. And that was okay because it was time. The duplex saved us a lot of money. You know, if I'd rented a proper office from the beginning, the company wouldn't have survived. We would have run out of money. But you know, it was nerve-wracking living in the duplex. We had a City of Calgary depot right across the street. And it was nerve-wracking whenever we had a big truckload of something comes in from China, or you know, like six skids come in and you see the city trucks driving by as you're unloading. You know, you get them to drive around in the alley and you hope this big truck doesn't pull down the power lines in the back alley. So it was, in a lot of ways, it was great to get out of the house. By the time we moved, I hadn't been living in the house. Marta bought a house. But we had 250 boxes of products stacked up in our house because there wasn't room at the company anymore. So this is the kind of inconvenience that happens when you run a company. And Marta was actually surprisingly tolerant of that. But she put her foot down when I wanted to use some of the boxes as furniture in our living room. Because I needed a projector stand, so I figured we'll just stack up 12 boxes and we'll throw a sheet over it, and there's my projector stand. No. Took me years to understand why that wasn't okay. So I have to stress that these are all problems of growth. The faster your business grows, the faster these problems pop up. And Band-Aid solutions don't work. You know, you need to solve the underlying issues of these problems so it doesn't come back in 6 months. And in my experience, when your company grows 100%, every problem in your company will grow 400%. So every process and system that has not been really carefully designed will just fall apart. Every little process people are running in the back of their head that's a little bit shaky, it all falls apart every time you double the size of your company. So growing from 50,000 a year in revenue to 50 million a year in revenue, it's basically 2 to the 10. So it would be, you'd have to rebuild your company 10 times. And, you know, by the time you've rebuilt your company 10 times, you probably find that the biggest impediment to growth is yourself. So we all have limits. So for me, every growth problem has been an opportunity for personal growth, usually grudging. Usually I'm not very happy about having to change what I believe. But one ongoing issue at the company has been particularly challenging, and I'll go through it. And that has been to get somebody else in the company running manufacturing, where I don't have to worry about, you know, the build plan and purchasing components and how many components do we need to purchase, because I'm not really that organized. I'm not very good at it. But so I'll go through trying to get someone else running this. Because this is an example. As you build the company, you have to give away this work that you're doing to other people and get them doing it. And you discover that it takes an army. As the company grows, it ends up taking an army to do this stuff that you were just doing on the back of napkins. So we have a tool, MRP, where we plan production in, but only I could run it. And Phidgets was a one-man show, and I sat down to build boards. This was the extreme of no documentation. I wouldn't have any documentation for the board at all. I would just take my rolls of components and take my tweezers, and I knew where to put everything because I designed all the boards myself. Marta remembers that. It was pretty crazy days. And when we outsourced everything to manufacture to China, well, we had to have a little bit of documentation, but it was still really, really the bare minimum. And I was the only person who could pull together a build plan. You know, there was a person who ran accounting, Peter, so I could give him the list of components to buy, so I didn't have to be involved in everything. But there was a lot of little pieces of information that were only in my head. And I could go tell them to somebody else. But a day later, they've forgotten half of it. And they can write it down on pieces of paper, but then they end up with a big stack of paper, and they don't have any hope of actually getting that piece of information when they need it. I'll diverge a little bit from the script with a funny story. Back in 2006, 2007, when we first started making stuff in China, we were making some motor controllers, and I knew that they were failing more than they should, so it was an obsolete design. And I knew we shouldn't make them anymore. There's other guys who were thinking about how much we should make, and even though we already had 1,000 of these sitting under a shelf, I would just hear people talking in the company, and they would say, we need to make more of that. And I would walk over there and I would say, they're all underneath the shelf right there. You don't need to make any more of those ever again. And then 2 weeks later, I would hear the same conversation coming up again, because human memory is just not that great. You can't plan manufacturing based on human memory. When there's a piece of information, it has to go into a well-designed system. So the first production run, where I'm just advising, we didn't start this production run until December 2013, 2 months ago. So I'll go through in a little bit more detail of the sorts of reasons why it didn't go on, didn't start, why I had to be basically running it hands-on until 2 months ago. So we needed a computer system with sales forecasting, understands manufacturing, purchasing delays, shipping around the world, product kitting in Canada, obsolete products. And that's okay. We had an MRP system already, but it has deficiencies in it. For instance, as an example of a sort of deficiency where I could run the system and account for it, maybe we have a product we'll sell out in 6 months, and 6 months from now, all that sales will transfer to a new product that we will have released by that time. And basically, you know, your product sells down to zero, new product shows up, sales jump up, and your inventory starts. This is the sort of thing you have to be able to model. And if your system can't model all these picky little problems, then the person who's running the system has to always be accounting for them in the plan. And if your system can't model everything accurately, then people make mistakes. And because I had the whole company in my head and I was involved with all those products, then I could account for them. But other people, if your modeling is not really, really good, then they make mistakes. And when people start making obsolete products and buying components for them, those tend to be really expensive mistakes. Another picky issue. Let's say your software understands obsolescence, it understands how that affects sales, but when you're sitting in a discussion, when you're having a meeting, we don't have that many meetings, but when you're having a meeting, you decide to kill a product, the software database is not in the room. Somebody has to go and change that setting. And so you think, oh, that's okay, you know, person just goes and changes it. But if it's only happening once every 3 months, chances are they're gonna forget it. So, you know, you can add it to the process diagram to update the database, but people don't look at process diagrams. These systems, processes live in people's heads. And you can reinforce them when mistakes are made. But a lot of processes just rely on people to remember to do the right thing. So many of us have grown up making fun of big companies and their inefficiencies, but I'm personally amazed that, you know, a company like UPS with 250,000 people, that they can turn the lights on in the morning and have the company run at all. And the reason that I think companies run is because you have lots of people who know their jobs and the processes are fairly stable. And when you start a small company, you realize just how, I haven't seen Frank in years. Hi, Frank. When you start a company, you realize how hard it is to get consistency, especially when, you know, processes are changing and quite often it's not clear who owns a particular process. As an example, we used to do all of our packaging in Canada. We would get the boards made in China, but then we would package them in Canada. So we had one product which was packaged the same as all the other products, except it needed a little plastic knob. And over all the packaging production runs, basically somebody sits down at a table and puts them in a bag, of all the packaging production runs that we did in Canada, probably 25% of the knobs didn't go into the bags. And we had to open them up again. You know, that's because with our culture of strong manufacturing culture at Phidgets, we're more of a design shop than we are a manufacturing house. The guys who are planning the builds, who are putting together the components, they just wouldn't look at the documentation because they knew how it was supposed to be done. And of course they're wrong because they're just working from memory. And this is the sort of problem you face. You're running a company, you think, I'm trying to grow a high-tech business here, and we can't even put a knob in a bag. So getting back to delegating tasks, when I was doing the work, I could use all the context that I had, the fact that I'd been involved in everything in the company, to avoid becoming organized, because I could just sort of run the whole thing in my head and deal with problems, and you know, a person would do a passable job. But as soon as you give it to somebody else, they cannot be that disorganized or it will be an immediate disaster. So you really need to make a huge effort to get everything organized. And so I find now, instead of you know, being disorganized Chester running a process without any system at all, just doing it intuitively, instead I can use my intuition and all the context I have to walk around and watch for mistakes. So people are supposed to be organized now, but they still make mistakes. But I can see the mistakes coming from, as long as I'm vaguely involved in the processes, I can catch a lot of errors, which is much better than to have somebody else running a process regularly and trying to do a good job and me just catching errors. So in the past, when I would give a process to somebody and I would see them losing control of it, they're starting to make mistakes, they're starting to get confused, I would just jump in and I would say, okay, give me that back, you go do this other thing. This is really, really a bad habit. Ownership is like vitamin C for a company. People love to have responsibilities, to have tasks and projects they own. And taking away someone's ownership of a system is really, really demotivating for them. Sometimes it's still necessary, but we absolutely try to minimize it. But it can be pretty frustrating for me to watch somebody take a month to do something for the first time that I would have done in 4 hours. So I'm very goal-oriented, and I've had to change my goals from being getting the job done to training someone to the point that I can trust their judgment 100%. And it's pretty rewarding it takes a lot of investment, but after you get somebody running a process and they're doing it much better than you ever were. So some, I hope this gives you some sense of how hard it can be to delegate and get the results you want. Some days I feel like I'm going to have to burn the company to the ground to fix one picky little issue that just won't go away. And people challenge me on it. Sometimes it turns out that I'm just obsessing about something that's stupid and we can just completely ignore it, safely ignore it for a while. But you know, sometimes you might have to solve 30 other issues to make this one problem go away. But usually all those 30 issues have to be solved anyway, so it's worth it. And one nice benefit of delegating is that when I'm not doing the job, it becomes much easier to make clear decisions. As an example, when I planned production, I didn't really like planning production, and I didn't want to look at these products again for a while, so I would produce a lot. And now that somebody else is planning production, you can bet that I don't let them spend an extra $200,000 on a production run because they're tired of doing their job. And it sounds silly, but it's actually quite hard to make good business decisions in a small company. For instance, if you're running a big company, you won't buy some fancy piece of equipment, some big machine that you like, because you want to play with it. You make up a business justification for it. In a big company, you would never even see the machine, so you don't care. You just make a business decision. And whether some guy on the floor using the machine wants to play with it or not, it's irrelevant to you. Of course, I think when you run a big company, instead what you want is the biggest skyscraper in downtown Calgary. That's my suspicion. Now, another common misjudgment is automating things that don't have to be automated. As an example, our shipping software with UPS is really heavily automated. And when we ship with FedEx, it's totally manual. So if I had to ship one FedEx shipment, it's so manual and so painful that I would just take FedEx off the website as a shipping option. Even though we know that this is a good strategic decision to do, it's just so painful to do that work. And we can't justify the effort to automate it right now. So fortunately, my shipper, he doesn't mind the manual work quite so much. So he does it, he ships all the orders, and then I can make strategic decisions. And if I was doing the work, I would not be able to make clear strategic decisions. Well, I protect against my own bad decisions by letting other people shoot them down. Actually, I have to demand that other people attack my ideas, and I congratulate them when they succeed and my idea goes down in flames. But almost no one is comfortable attacking the boss's brainchild. I really have to encourage people to try to tear down an idea. So I have a favorite joke. Actually, I told it here already tonight. Business is all about people. Profit is just the side effect of squeezing them hard enough. First part is true. Fidgets is 18 people. It's not very big, but even at this size, there's very little real work I can do to move the needle. The best lever available is to hire smart people and make sure they're working on the right things. It's been a real joy to hire young developers and see them buy houses and get married and start families. I don't worry about making payroll. I mean, it's nice to be able to not worry about making payroll. Not every company has that luxury. But even if Fidgets went broke, Calgary's a rich city. These are smart guys. They could get another job. I worry that, you know, work is a tremendously large part of our jobs, part of our lives. And as a boss, it's really easy to have a negative impact on someone's life. And the flip side of that is if I can make sure that their work fits who they are, make sure that the work is necessary and is being done to a high standard, then everyone loves it. So I feel a pressure every day that everyone I work with deserves to do important work that challenges them and to know if they're doing a good job. It's interesting that companies put so much effort into controlling every little detail of sort of regular people doing work, but they're totally vulnerable to corruption or bad leadership from the top. As a lot of companies succeed, the owners become complacent, they develop expensive hobbies, maybe buy a hockey team. Even more insidious is starting another company. At least once a week, someone with full confidence will tell me that I need to start a second company. It just happened yesterday. Just let these guys run this company. It'll be fine. But I only know of one person who has the capacity to run two companies, and it's not for mere mortals running two companies. This, my rule, is only one company. If I want to start another company, I have to sell this one or shut it down. But even with one company, if I go to work and feel like everything's running smoothly, that's a red flag that I'm not paying attention. The safest policy is to never be complacent, because there's always something to worry about. You know, sometimes it's nice to enjoy the moments when things are going smoothly for an hour or two, but no more than that. There's always something coming. So you might ask about my long-term vision for Phidgets. My vision is really simple. I'm tired of the current crop problems. I want to fix them so I can find new interesting problems. Some books say the CEO should be thinking 10 years out. I can't imagine thinking 10 years out. I think I would have a nervous breakdown if I thought 10 years in the future. I don't think past 24 months. So when I say that to someone, I think they're probably envisioning a company that's in crisis mode, just fighting fires all the time, fighting short-term problems. And that's not actually how it works. I generate most of the problems at Phidgets. I decide this is going to be an issue, some problem coming, and I generate the crisis. And I say, this has to be dealt with now. And I think this is probably fairly common. You know, in a high-tech company, if your sales have flattened out and are starting to drop before you decide to deal with it, it's already too late. You know, we've seen that with BlackBerry, which has been kind of painful. But one thing that is clear to me about the future of Phidgets, there's enough raw brain power and wisdom within my team to deal with the problems we're facing. And I'm not going to hire a bunch of C-level managers, parachute in some powerful executives to take the company to the next level. I don't think they would be able to figure out our reality better than we already have. And company culture is a precious thing, and the company culture at Phidgets is amazing. The most common concern among the people who work at Phidgets, we just went through employee evaluations, which is a funny process at Phidgets. The most common concern among people who work at Phidgets is how can they contribute more. One of my guys, I hired Bernard when he was 61 years old, and he was semi-retired, just waiting for his wife to retire. And now he's 67, he has no plans to retire. He tells his wife to go travel on her own because he's not interested in retiring. And he just gets up every morning and comes to work, and he loves it. So it's really a special place, and it happens to be profitable. So we're going to change the format now to just asking a short list of questions. That was all the talk that I felt like writing. But we do have a dozen questions. Oh, yeah, I have to give you the questions. Yep. And then after we punch through these questions, after Cameron asks these questions, then we'll just open it up for general questions.
All right, first question. Who buys Phidgets?
So I had a discussion with this fellow here about this. He went to the website, and he was asking some pretty hard questions. And people, when they go on the website, they feel like it's hobbyist. And this is on purpose. Most of our customers are industrial and commercial users. But these customers push the product line so hard and expect so much out of them that on our website, we don't want to encourage them to use them in industrial uses. A lot of the industrial users do have success with the product line, but we deliberately undersell what the product line can do. So most of the users of Phidgets are small companies they don't have electrical engineers in-house. They just have programmers, and they've got some idea of building a machine. I just had did a little bit of support with a customer who is building a machine that measures the amount of methane that cows emit, which is not something I would have identified as a potential market. We don't know what the vast majority of customers do, and really, we shouldn't have to. We're selling a tool. It's interesting to know what they do, but most of them won't tell us. So that's who buys Phidgets. There are some hobbyists. There are some people making robots, but in reality, almost every customer is different.
All right. Who are your competitors?
So we think of our competitors in sort of a vertical stack. Above us on the industrial to hobbyist scale is companies like National Instruments and Allen Bradley, companies making PLCs. And there's a little bit of overlap there. But we don't see this kind of, we don't see Allen Bradley trying to move down and trying to make a $100 PLC, for instance. And then below us, well, not really below, but closer to the hobbyist end of things, there's companies like Arduino and Raspberry Pi and SparkFun. And those are also competitors. You know, it's something customers have to consider when they're selecting a product. So it's actually, there's not really anything like a toilet paper market where companies are, there's two companies selling toilet paper and they're just going head to head. It's a, depends how broadly you want to consider your customers, your competitors, I mean.
All right, what's the most common mistake starting a business?
The common mistake I see all the time, and I'm always trying to help my friends correct it, and they never listen, is accounting. If, unless you know something about creating an accounting system and getting it going, you're not going to be able to design it and architect it and start using it every day. So what happens usually is a small company will just collect all the receipts in a shoebox, and then at the end of the year, you wish that you could succeed, but you plow for, well, you just ignore it and you start a new shoebox. And companies end up years and years behind on their taxes. And that can become really, really expensive. So it actually is not that bad if you get somebody to help you set up an accounting system. But it gets very expensive if it's not set up. And I can extend that invitation to come over to my house and talk about accounting. It's actually really cool.
Do you see any business opportunities?
Well, so this would be a question from someone just saying, what business opportunities do I see? I mean, this is a really, really broad question. One thing that I see in a lot of industries is companies will become really focused on the high end. Like, I have a flight simulator at home, and I use flight simulators. I'm part of a gliding club where we use flight simulators to train people. And companies that make flight simulators, they tend to believe that unless your flight simulator is FAA certified so that it counts toward your pilot's license, it's a piece of junk. The whole industry is deviated that way. So if you can identify within an industry that all the companies are leaning one way, there may be just a whole, a broad market that they just don't take seriously. I had some other points on that, but I forget. One thing which is important when you're starting out a company is to decide if it's a service company or if it's a product company. And in my experience, you decide that based on your own personality. If you're really interested in solving customers' problems, then you start a service company. If you've got a vision of what you want to make and you don't care what anybody says, then you'd better start a product company. And you pick one or the other, there's two sort of maxima there, and in the middle there's just death. You can't be both.
How has being located in Calgary affected Phidgets?
Well, you know, the idea of Phidgets came out of the University of Calgary, and I've been really, I see the University of Calgary never seems to rank very highly in the McLean's rankings, which I don't care about at all. To me, the University of Calgary was really accommodating. They let me overload courses and make my own interesting courses. Saul Greenberg had this excellent idea. So to me, the University of Calgary has been a very positive influence in my life. Overall, running my company in Calgary, I mean, I like Calgary. I like having the mountains there. I don't want to move elsewhere, especially now that I've got all these great people working for me. But Calgary is an expensive place. We have some American competitors who are paying half of what we pay. So So, you know, people worry about China. Well, I worry about the Americans. And warehousing in the United States costs a quarter in a lot of places, an office. It's really, really cheap. And Calgary is not that cheap. So that's mostly what I think about Calgary these days, is that this is an expensive place to be, and it's really far from our main markets. Calgary is... the Americans are 50% of our business. But I don't want to move to America, so we're just going to deal with it.
How will rising labor prices in China affect your production and outsourcing in general?
This is something that I discuss all the time when friends come over to our house, and it's really conscientious, so I figured we'll just get it out there because it's kind of fun. I spent Christmas and New Year's at a factory in China for 3 weeks supervising production because I promised the guy, the regular guy who goes over there, that he wouldn't have to spend another Christmas in China. Because last year he was there for 3 months. That didn't really seem fair. So I got to spend 3 weeks at a factory and see how the factories really work. You know, it's very different being there for 3 weeks versus being there for 2 hours. And, you know, I guess a 50% increase in labor costs seems substantial to us, but if it's going from $15 a day to $22 a day, it's still not a huge cost. And these factories, as the price goes up, they'll just figure out how to get by with less people. So I don't see it being a major factor in the next 10 years. And as labor costs go up, they'll just start moving factories further inland. Because they have to pay quite a price premium in China to get people to move away from their families and work in the export cities. So eventually, when it becomes worth it, they will just move to where the people are.
What would I tell someone considering outsourcing manufacturing to Asia?
Another common question. It can be a big, big investment. Sometimes I have people come to me and they say, I'm making 500 boards. Do you think it's worth going to China? And absolutely not. China is a very, in general, I don't know about the rest of Asia. We just work in China. But it's kind of an opaque place. It takes years to really learn what's going on. And it's kind of like New York. You know, if you go to New York, if you grew up in New York, you don't get stabbed on your first night. You don't get stabbed. And if you're a tourist, you get stabbed on your first night. Not that I'm worried about getting stabbed in China, but just in general, on the business side, particularly when dealing with individuals, it can be kind of tricky. So unless you're willing to make an investment and get burned and just keep at it until you figure it out, it's not going to be worth it. It won't be a success experience.
How can Canada become a manufacturing superpower?
Okay, good. That's the right reaction. The reality is, you go and you hang out in a factory in China of 5,000 people that are pumping out 40 million cell phones a year, and you realize that manufacturing is really, really hard work. Just as a show of hands here, who would want their kids to grow up to become a production superintendent or supervisor on a factory floor? Nobody. And it takes smart people to run a factory. It's hard work, takes smart people, and Canada is just too rich. You know, we don't want our kids to go work in factories. So really, I think Canada's strength is we have lots of resources and we should just turn them into cash as slowly as we can, make them last a long time.
Well, excellent feed to the next question of how will higher oil prices affect viability of manufacturing overseas?
I hope some of you would have asked these questions. I hope you find these questions interesting. What people don't realize is that ocean containers, these big bulk freighters that travel around the sea, these ships really don't burn that much fuel. It's only about 10 tons an hour, which is about $10,000 per hour. it seems like a lot of fuel, but they're also carrying such a huge amount of product that it's such a small part of the overall cost. And even if the price of oil does go so high that it becomes a problem, they will just slow them down. Right now, they're taking containers come across the sea in 2 weeks, and they could burn 75% less fuel by taking 4 weeks instead. And, you know, we would never know that our iPhones took 4 weeks to come here instead of 2 weeks. So I don't think that the price of oil is likely to cause a problem, except for perhaps, making styrofoam cups overseas. That could be the kind of marginal case where, you know, it makes sense to come back local. There's certainly lots of marginal cases where, you know, it can go one way or it can go the other.
All right, last question here. What do you think about human rights abuses at factories in China?
Save the hottest one for last. Well, I've got to see some factories in China. Obviously, I haven't seen them all. And I think there are probably some serious human rights abuses in China. But it's not the problem that gets played up in the media. The news in the media about the Foxconn workers committing suicide. It's when you hear about 10 workers in one factory committing suicide, it sounds appalling. But the reality is that factory is half the size of Calgary. The factories are quite, they're pressure cookers. I mean, there's lots of pressure to get stuff out before Christmas, and perhaps that has some effect on it, but the fact is that the suicide rate is still very, very low compared to the average of China and especially compared to the average in Canada. There's no question that it's very boring work. I would not want to do it, and a lot of Chinese people don't want to do it either, and a lot of them just don't do it because just sitting there and doing the same thing for 8 hours is not what they want to do. So to me, the real problem with the Chinese factory system is the fact that it splits up families, and that, you know, mothers and fathers will move away from their families and will let the grandparents raise the children because they need some money to keep the family farm going. So to me, that's the real problem. And long term, they have to somehow integrate the families back together. But it just wasn't practical to move everyone's families, you know, to move an extra 300 million people into the export cities, so they can be with the father or the mother. So to me, that's the real problem in China. And a lot of the other stuff that we hear is largely just being made up, I believe. Okay? It's kind of a conscientious subject, heavy one.
So from how you describe the factories, it sounds like there's not very much automated. Is that correct? Everything's done by hand for the most part? Or?
Well, I think it depends on the type of factory. The factories we work with are, I would say the level of automation is identical to what you would see in an equivalent factory here. You know, the factory making circuit boards or assembling circuit boards or making cell phones or whatever. Not that there's any making cell phone factories left over here. Yeah, the level of automation is the same, I would say.
Any other questions?
Uh-oh. This guy asked a tough question.
This one is easy. How much it would be easier if you were just making or selling software? You had no, like, you didn't need to sell hardware. It's just software. So was it 100 times easier, or maybe just 2 times or 5 times, something like that? Like how much?
Well, certainly, you know, manufacturing software, you know, manufacturing hardware, if you make it wrong, that can be really, really bad. You know, you're looking at a lot of fixing things by hand and little yellow wires on your board, or potentially throwing it away, whereas software, you know, you just ship a new version and away you go. I think, though, it would be easier. I'm not sure, though, how you would charge anybody money for software in this day and age. Getting trickier all the time, I think. But I think that in the software space, because you don't have that hurdle of dealing with manufacturing hardware, I think you face more competition as a result of that. Like if you look at the competition to produce an iPhone app or Android app that gets attention, there's so many people making these pieces of software that's pretty severe competition. So perhaps it's easier, but the competition is more severe.
Chester, you actually advised us not to start a company.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering for yourself I presume that you now think it's worth it that you started a company. And if you did get a job back in 2002, do you think that you would have found that boring and you would have wound up starting something on your own anyway? Or do you think that, you know, there's something in you and about you that made you starting a company kind of inevitable?
Well, my father ran a small oil field service company. So I started a company based on the work he didn't want to do when I was 13. And once you start a company and you have some kind of success, it becomes really hard to work for somebody ever again. So I think, you know, the reality after running that through junior high and high school is that probably if I had got a job at Cisco, I don't think I would have lasted very long, because you just, you know, you get ordered to do things you don't agree with and it's just too hard. So I probably would have ended up starting a company anyway. So the correct response when I tell people don't start a company, the correct response is, well, I don't care, I'm going to do it anyway. And then, okay, let's talk. If someone can't cross that small hurdle, then they don't have much hope starting a company. You have to be a little bit stubborn.
Three questions for you.
Three
quick ones. Did you ever consider investment? At what points did you do that, and why did you choose not to?
I had a question from somebody I was ice climbing with years and years ago of, you know, wouldn't it be better to have 10% of a multi-billion dollar company? And my answer was no. No, I don't want to have to take orders from somebody else. And when you do have investors, you know, it means you have a boss. So I also would have a hard time facing somebody and telling them that I had lost all their money. That would be really hard. You know, it's probably wouldn't be so hard from somebody who has dollars, but if it's somebody who remortgaged their house to invest in you, that would be painful. So I never ever seriously considered getting investment. But I'm sure it's an interesting skill in its own right of how to get and how to manage investors.
First of all, a comment, Chester, is that mm-hmm. what I found really engaging about your presentation, your introspection, which is in short supply in Calgary for the most part. People don't question what they're doing for the most part.
Right.
You do, and I'm impressed by that. It's really quite remarkable, and I've heard a fair number of speakers. My question is, again, about the Calgary marketplace or the Calgary locale to start a business. You've already characterized it as being expensive. Can you spend a little time just talking about Calgary as a place to hire programmers and to receive the support of the business community, those kinds of things? I've got an opinion, but that doesn't matter. I'd be very interested in hearing your perspective in terms of, you know, is this the right place to start your kind of business? And if you could do it all over again, might you do it somewhere else?
Well, one of the guys at work, he said several times, so I remember it, that when he moved here from Montreal, he was surprised when the Yellow Pages was bigger than the White Pages. And I don't know if that's true. I can't believe they still print Yellow Pages and White Pages. But there's a lot of businesses in Calgary. You know, Alberta has an entrepreneurial spirit to it. And I think that sort of thing helps. It just helps to have that in the culture. I don't really have much to do with the local Calgary business community in general. So I can't say that much about what it's like to work with them. But I did start a business, an oil field business, when I was 13 years old, and that was fun. And people actually trusted me with work, which is a little bit shocking.
Just a follow-up question.
Mm-hmm. At this point, we are using the Research and Development Tax Credit Program, which has turned out to be great. For years, I fought against using SRED because I just was raised with this Alberta, you know, no government on my land kind of approach to thing. But, you know, in reality, it's been surprisingly lightweight, and it pays for itself many times over for the investment of effort in being organized and using SRED. Yeah, that's all we use. Yeah.
Hi.
Hi again.
I remember Chester from our first month as being a master student. For me, it was quite an interesting experience coming from a different country, so I was aware of everybody. Okay, here's my question. What is your suggestion in as an approach to get contracts?
As an approach, you
should find contracts.
What kind of contracts are you looking for? Programming contracts?
Close to programming service, yeah.
I don't know, maybe I should get my wife to speak on that. My wife was a project manager for the National Energy Board, and they hire contractors and so on. You know, within Phidgets, I find that we don't really hire very many contractors. It just doesn't... Yeah, it doesn't work for us. I like to have very, very long-term relationships with my developers.
This is not what I refer to. It's when you sell your product, right?
Yeah, sure.
So,
yes.
Now you have a website, right?
Yes.
And you base your sales a lot on the website.
Yes.
But is that an effective way? Are you using marketing? Are you? How did you start to, you know? How did you make your first sale?
Yeah, we created a website and we put it on the website and somebody clicked add to cart. This is something which is very, very new for us, actually doing real, making an effort on marketing. Up to this point, I've been sort of had the engineering deformity that we'll just redesign the product line again. We don't want to sell it. Let's just make the next one. And, you know, you worry about picky little things that customers don't care about. Customers think it's great. They're thinking, why are you redesigning that? It's fine. And over the last couple of years, I've become open to the idea that we do actually, it's a reasonable thing to make sure more people know about your product. And so actually just this week, I hired two people in our first marketing department. So this is a very,
congratulations,
very bold new step for us. It scares me sometimes. But so far, for our first almost 12 years of operation, we really haven't made any kind of concerted effort on marketing at all. It's just purely based on pull.
Thank you.
You mentioned that you had a defect rate of 25% somewhere in the middle of your company.
Oh, I see. No, that was, we put the wrong thing in. We didn't put it in the bag 25% of the time.
No,
and then,
sorry.
And then you open it up again.
The circuit boards. But there was a time when you were getting a product back from China, but it was flawed.
Oh, no. This was, we were getting the board from China, and all we had to do was put it in a bag with a little knob, and we would forget to put the knob in on 25% of our little packaging jobs we did internally. It wasn't a defect rate on the product coming from. Oh, are you saying the original?
Yeah.
The one that you had 1,000 on the shelf. You had to repair them all.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, I see. I must have just confused you guys.
Okay.
But so that was the one we had to repair everything. That was from a Canadian contract manufacturer.
And so what would your defect rate be with using a offshore?
Because our products are fairly simple compared to their what the contract manufacturer normally works with, we're about 0.1% right now. So on 0.1.
The reason I was asking was that typically you can push back and say, listen, this rate is way too high.
Right.
It's unacceptable.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
It shouldn't have been on your side of the fence to fix, but
right.
Now
yeah.
with that clarification yeah. that it was a Canadian company that had that.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, and you know that would have been, with our original production run back in 2006, we had waited about 3 months for the boards to be repaired, and they really didn't want to make an investment in the rework equipment. So at some point, I just decided, game over. No, there was no test at all. But it was just obvious, just based on, you know, looking at them from here, that it was wrong. But again, you know, this was a company which had their strength. And their strength was they had some sales. The strength was that they had some ladies who worked there who were really good at hand assembly. And then they picked up a small surface mount machine and assumed that it would be easy. And in reality, it's never easy to add a new manufacturing process. So, after waiting for 3 months, I just decided it was time to just get it done. Yeah, it was painful. And you know, with in China as well, if you go to China and you buy purely based on price, this is actually an interesting point. You go to China, you get 10 different factories to quote on something, and if you choose, okay, cheapest one gets the job, you're dead. You have to make sure that the factory is good. Make sure that this is something that they can really do, that they're really comfortable with. And, you know, in the case of our Canadian experience, we were scraping the bottom of the barrel to get something that was economical for us. And I'm sure that if we didn't scrape the bottom of the barrel, it would have been quite reasonable.
I was wondering about your employees and how you incent them, how you pay them.
Money.
Any of them? But is it only money? No. Shares, options, ownership in the company?
We
bonus schemes.
Bonus schemes? I guess I'll start with ones that we definitely don't do. I'm kind of afraid of bonus schemes. I think it's generally a bad idea to, you know, people already want to do a good job. And, you know, to say, you know, if you do a really, really, really good job here, we'll give you some extra money. I just seen a TED talk on this, that the incentives start to compete. So we don't do any bonuses. We do have some mild benefits. The Private Health Services Plan, PHSP, these are an amazing approach to medical benefits from the government, where you get to write off your employees' health expenses. And on options, the plan long term is that, you know, the employees who are obviously with the company for their whole careers, they will be given options for sure.
So if the company does well in a particular year, there's no, like, how do you celebrate that? Wouldn't there be some resentment if it all went to you?
Well, I leave it all in the company. I'm just paid as a salaried employee as well.
Yeah.
We call it a growth-oriented nonprofit. but there was a point I wanted to make on that. As the company grows, we can afford to pay people more money, and they see their salaries go up.
Yeah, I'm just curious about the product itself. I mean,
yeah, there hasn't been very much discussion of that.
Like, I don't really know exactly what it is, like some sensors or something like that. Have you ever thought of actually creating an application for, let's say, the energy industry here, if it's applicable?
Well, this is an interesting thing, that we see a lot of our competitors, you know, you're making a module, you're making a motor controller, and then you realize that if you take this motor controller and you put it in a robot, you make a robot around it, you could sell the whole system. And you know, my policy is that, you know, I have a functioning company which is profitable, so I don't like to stray too far from what works. And I feel like once we decide that we're going to make, you know, consumer targeted products, I feel like that would take so much energy out of the effort to provide really good sort of tools to someone who's building their own systems, that I don't think that you could accommodate those competing interests within the same company. I think one or the other one would win, and it would just vacuum so much resources out of, you know, providing excellent APIs, that you would lose the edge on that side.
Do you have any examples of some of the applications that perhaps, you know, the Phidgets could be used for?
Sure. We have a couple thousand USB accelerometers, which Caltech has determined is good enough to measure earthquakes with. Our accelerometers are sort of the very best that can be done with cheap sensors. So they have a community seismic network, CSN, which is scatters accelerometers in people's houses all over Los Angeles and San Francisco. And the idea being that when the software running spots an earthquake, they'll ship the data into a central server. And the theory is that eventually, as the earthquake propagates out, they'll be getting alarms, so they could text message everybody and say, you better get out of the building or pull over your car or whatever. So that's an example application. Yeah, Trevor's wife uses Phidgets. She's a computer science and arts major. Interesting combination.
So she gutted a jukebox, a 50s jukebox, and put electronic components in, and now when you press the buttons, it's a computer. So it does stuff. Launches videos and audio.
I like motor controllers because they're really hard, and if you don't get the control right, the motors will just blow up the controller that it's plugged in. I'm just trying to think of some other example projects. So the distance learning department of education in Newfoundland has sent out our little single board computers and motor controllers and some sensors to all of the students that are in these little fishing villages along the edge of Newfoundland. And each student, they program in Visual Basic, I think, each student builds a little robot and they bend sheet metal. And these are little fishing villages where there's usually just one or two students total through all grades. And these kids are out there making their own robots and programming them. Funny how hard it is to think of applications when flight simulators. Yeah, a lot of even commercial flight simulator companies will use our digital input boards to interface all the switches in a commercial flight simulator, for instance. There could be hundreds and hundreds of switches going in there. I won't mention the name of the company. There's a big company down in the United States that has automated robots. This is just based on our guess, because they don't tell us. They have automated robots that drive around a factory floor, a huge factory floor, 24 hours a day. They just follow a path on the floor. So they've embedded little RFID tags and a metal strip in the floor, and they drive around and around carrying something. We don't know. In a big factory. And there's 60 of these trucks, we don't know how big they are, but they are fairly big, going around and around. The United States Air Force will make arrays of antennas and hang them underneath of planes and so they can be flying up at 50,000 feet and be servoing this array of antennas, doing something or other. Again, we don't know what. Yeah, some kind of beam forming or... Right. There's been a fair number of sales into RFID. I don't know if you know RFID. This is the, you unlock with a door. We make a reader. We've been making readers for probably the last 12 years. And so they'll just sell, they just give an access card to new customers. And then a programmer who works for a franchise of gyms will just create a software application, and then they can track people as they scan in and out. There's been a large number of RFID readers go to what we think is a franchise of nursing homes in Britain. And this is used for timekeeping for the employees as they scan in and as they leave. So instead of using punch cards, instead, if you work at the nursing home, you have your little key fob on your keychain, and you scan in when you show up in the morning. And then the payroll and everything is automated off of that.
So you've said that you haven't traditionally done marketing, and that your website is targeted towards more like hobbyist type purposes. So I'm curious, number one, how you're promoting the product, and number two, how you forecast demand.
Our website, I find, in my opinion, is sort of very dry and technical. We just provide information. And compared to a lot of hobbyist sites, we provide a lot of information. And we're very sort of engineering-oriented compared to a lot of the competitors. But, it depends. If you're comparing to somebody who's selling a $100,000 PLC, then we seem extremely hobbyist. And if you're a hobbyist coming in, then we seem kind of industrial. But our approach to marketing has just been Google. People search for products. People search for a problem they have. And hopefully, they come across us. So we'll be making more of an effort to make sure there's more material on the web. Because what we find is the majority of Phidgets customers are doing something that they don't talk about. They have some internal project within their company, or they have a business idea. That's another reason I don't want to talk about a lot of the applications of Phidgets, is a lot of these applications are ideas that people have had, and they're actively trying to turn them into companies. But we will be making more of an effort, and we feel like we're sort of playing at a disadvantage compared to something like Arduino. And with an Arduino, it's much more open, so people can spend months and months building a circuit with it and going on forums and chatting with their friends about how to control a motor. Whereas if they buy a Phidget, even if they are inclined to go online and chat about it, it just works. And if it doesn't work, then we RMA it and we send them another one. But by and large, they do just work, and it doesn't generate a lot of web traffic, which is an interesting problem. And this is just something we're starting to study now.
And how do you forecast demand?
How do we forecast demand? I mean, a lot of this stuff, a lot of the forecasts, the really gray problems in the company, we just run on pure intuition. If we're making a new product and we don't know, then we do a smaller production run the first time just to check it out, because you don't know. And once products are out, they seem to be fairly stable. So we build based on previous demand. It's not very fancy.